Hello everybody, this is Juan. I wanted to publish a series of videos about the implementations of the vendor decomposition algorithm in Cplex. This has been done, the task that I've been doing in the last weeks for my PhD. And I think that yes, it could be useful for somebody else trying to do a similar task. So the main purpose will be to show you the features of Cplex that allow to implement vendors, but also I would like to give a little bit of background in the algorithm itself. And yes, hope it can be useful for you. Yes, please feel free to write down in the video any comments you may have. So first, and in this video, I want to go through the introduction. In the following videos, we are going to go to the implementation. And finally, I will share some learnings of what I present you in this series of videos. So, something important, like these are my references. I'm gonna post you here in the video, the reference that I use to learn vendors. And here I have to make a special mention to my friend Danilo Abril, who helped me a lot to guide me through this process of learning vendors. So this video of Professor Srinivasan is very interesting because he shows an implementation of vendors for solving mixed integer programming problems. And this implementation is very specific to a single LP. So it's a good introduction before starting to play with more generic stuff. Pasara, in his book, Linear Programming and Network Flows, introduced the vendor decomposition algorithm, but focus on just the LP. So it's a good source also as well. And something of the most interesting thing that I read the most of Pasara is the chapter he has in linear algebra revision. I have to go back a little bit because I was a little bit dusty with my algebra, and it was very helpful to read this chapter. And in the vendor decomposition, there is a special step that in which we need to find unbounded graphs. Most of the vendors literature doesn't explain directly how to find that because it's a algebraic procedure, but Basara explains how to find about the section 2.6 of this book. I will post you the links. For a short, more generic introduction on vendors and in some tips on the implementation, I really enjoyed reading Arthur in his blog. He presented an example. This article from Erwin Kalbajit, which is a little bit from almost a couple of decades ago. It's very useful because he presents an implementation of vendors in GAMS. So if it's a code very easy to read, and and he presents the principles of vendors in a very easy way also. So it was very useful for me to do this. And the exercise I'm going to do is the same as he did in this article that we will be revising in more detail later. Also, I highly recommend you if you are a big user of Cplex,
following Paul Robin, the
professor Robin, he's
now retired, I think, but he writes a lot, and his articles were very helpful in this process of learning vendors. So, in one of his posts, he talks about the different ways to implement vendors in Cplex. So, what's a good source for him?
Another good source of information for me was this book of IBM. I don't know why, but it's not easy to find. It doesn't come with when you install Cplex, and it's a bit old, but it was so helpful. Maybe if you have started to learn Cplex recently, you know that it's not very easy to learn language. Not because it's difficult, it's because the documentation is not very well organized. So, but this book organized very well that information of Cplex and the fundamental concepts behind Cplex. So from this book, useful chapters to read. Okay, if you want to start using Cplex, this book is just amazing. Go for it, go for all the book or you can check what you need, but for my learning, my vendors implementation learning process, lesson two on data structure was very important to get familiar with the concept of tuples in Simplex. And lesson
three and 15 very important for learning the scripting language of Simplex.
How does it work? When, how does it work and how can you implement models to solve them sequentially as the vendor's algorithms requires? And finally, another very important source of information
in the implementation of vendors in Simplex was the example Simplex has on vendors' portfolio portfolio optimization, in which they use vendors. You can find this example in the Simplex example
library. So, apart from Danilo, these were my guidance in the process. So let me just start now to do a quick introduction of what is vendors and to go through the introduction of vendors. I want to use the article of Erwin where he introduces an implementation of vendors for GAMS. So vendors decomposition is a popular technique in solving certain classes of difficult problems, such as stochastic programming problems and mixed integer nonlinear programming problems. In this document, what this document does is presenting the vendor decomposition algorithm for a mixed integer programming problem, and they show the implementation in GAMS. Here in this series of videos, I want to show this implementation, but in Simplex. So let's go through a quick revision of what is vendors and how vendors work. So you have a mixed integer programming problem in which your y variables are considered the integer variables and the x variables are considered the continuous variables. You have this objective function c transpose x plus f transpose y subject to these constraints ax plus by greater than or equal to b. And here we have this special characteristic that we say that y belongs to the set y in which y are in integer variables. Usually this is the classical constraint. You say just here that y is an integer variable, but also you can have other type of constraints that only depend on y here in this set of constraints. So first, what the vendors like, let's think about the procedure a little bit. How does it work? And let's find the what is behind the scenes of vendors. So first, you said that, okay, let's say that I know why. Yes. If I know why, I can solve this resulting optimization problem. Yes. As y is a constant, I can leave it outside the objective function, and I will have this small problem. Let's call it this small subproblem. Let's minimize c transpose x subject to ax greater than or equal to b minus by bar. And here y bar represents the fixed value of y. Yes, and we know already from our original optimization problem that x is greater than or equal to zero. If we want to go back again to our original problem, it can be rewritten as follows. Look, we are gonna minimize expression. We will analyze these expressions, given some y's that are in this set of y's. Yes, and what expression do we want to minimize? F transpose y. Yes, and notice that the solution to this optimization problem or the objective function of this optimization problem, we can use it here, yes, to represent our original problem. Yes, then what it said, okay, let's take the dual of this subproblem. Yes, the dual of this subproblem is, okay, what is the dual? If you have a minimization problem, the dual will be a maximization problem. The coefficients of the objective functions are the right hand sides of the original problem. So what is the right hand side of the original problem? B minus BY, yes? But okay, remember here we are going to assume that we already knew Y, so that's why we are telling here Y bar. So B minus B times Y bar transpose times U. U is the vector or the array of the dual variables associated to the constraints of this problem. This is subject to A transpose, okay, to find the dual, you transpose this matrix times U, the dual variables. If it's a minimization problem and the constraints are of the type greater than or equal, when we're writing the dual will become a maximization problem and the constraints will be smaller than or equal to the equal to C, which are the cost coefficients of the original problem. I'm using the dual rules, you can also say that U, the dual variables, are greater than or equal to zero. Yes? So let's continue studying what is the Bender's algorithm. So we have here the master problem. Yes, Bender's will work solving a master problem, then Bender's will solve a subproblem. And the master problem will be this, minimize Z, yes? And this is a minimization problem where the variables are Y, yes? Where Z has to be greater than or equal to this expression, yes? We will analyze this expression in a second. And we have another expression here, another type of constraint, yes? Smaller than or equal to zero. And the constraint of Y belonging to Y. So let's analyze this expression, yes? If we see this expression, what is this expression? This expression is the same expression. Yeah. Why do we say that is the same expression? Look, FTY, yes, B minus BY transpose U bars K is referring to a given solution of this problem. Yes. Notice that in this problem, you can find all extreme points. Yes. Here we will say that this problem, this feasible region have K feasible, K extreme points. So what the master problem does is making a constraint for each extreme point of the subproblem. Yes. Of the dual subproblem. Yes. And how does it write the constraint? In this way. And why in this way? Not think about this. If this is a minimization problem, yes, and I have a feasible solution for this problem, and to this feasible solution, I add this value, yes? Notice that this value will be a lower bound for the objective function. Yes, because this optimization, this problem has many, 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 many solutions. Yes, but maybe one or many of them will be optimals. So we can guarantee that at the end, this value, the objective function of this problem will be greater than or equal to whatever solution here. Yes, like that's the reasoning of Bender's, but I suggest you to go through the evidence I gave you if you need more understanding. I just want to do a quick review here. So, and this constraint here represents. So I think I already said, I don't remember. Maybe I said already that this UK represents is an extreme point of this region. Yes? So that's UK. This constraint here is called a feasibility cut. And this constraint here
You will see in the following step when we explain the algorithm, this constraint is added here when you cannot solve this dual. When this dual is unbounded, you need to generate a specific constraint in the master problem for avoiding the solution. Yes, but when we go to the algorithm, I will go back again on this constraint to explain you a little bit better. And so this is a master problem minimized set subject to z greater than equal to this expression. And additionally, we have this other expression that are feasibility costs that we will be adding. We have sub problems of this form. Yes, given that we already know a y, we can solve this problem. Yes, and this in this problem, we are finding the values for u. So the Bender's algorithm can be stated as follows. First, we start with an initial feasible integer solution, y. Yes, we are going to say that the lower bound is a very, very small number, minus infinite, and an upper bound is infinite. This is the stop criteria of our algorithm. Yes, when the difference between the upper bound and the lower bound is very small, we are going to stop. But when the difference is big enough, and this is our parameter epsilon that will determine how big should be that difference, we will do this. Yes. So in the first step, we are going to solve the subproblem. Yes, and remember that the subproblem is the dual of a small portion of the original problem. So we are going to solve this subproblem. Once we solve this subproblem, we are going to check, hey, is the subproblem unbounded? If the subproblem is unbounded, we will need to generate an unbounded ray. Yes? And with this unbounded ray, we are going to generate a cut in the master. Yes, because the master starts empty. In the master, we don't have anything at the beginning. So at the first we're going to start to do with the master will be start adding constraints. Yes, the first constraint that we will add will be, if we find a feasible solution for the subproblem, we will make a constraint of this type. But if we don't find a feasible solution and the subproblem is unbounded, we will add a constraint of this type. Yes, but in order to add a constraint of this type, we need to find the value of that we call here u bar l. Yes. For finding the value of u bar l, you have to solve a system of equations. Yes. When we are doing the implementation, I will go through that system. I will show you what is the system that helps you to find the unbounded rate. Then we are here, okay, we are a code. If we find a solution for this problem, yes, it means that we got an extreme point of this feasible region and we are gonna add the cut of this form, yes? When we solve the dual subproblem, we are gonna ask if the upper bound of the algorithm should be updated. Yeah, so each time we solve the subproblem, we are gonna find an upper bound. Yes, and which will be the upper bound will be the upper bound in our previous iterations, the minimum between the upper bound in our previous iterations, and the solution to the subproblem in the current iteration. Yeah, so we update this. In case we update our upper bound. Then we solve the master problem. So, and this master problem will have an additional constraint from our previous master problem. Yes, we will add an optimality cut, which has this form, or we will add a feasibility cut, which will have this form. So we solve the master problem,
And this new solution of the master problem will be our new lower bound. Yes. Notice that what we are doing when we are solving our master problem is just adding constraints. So if I'm in a minimization problem, I am adding constraints, the objective function should keep the same or increase. Yes. So our lower bound should be always increasing. Yes. This reasoning doesn't apply for our upper bound. Okay, our upper bound should always decrease, but in each iteration, it not necessarily decreases. Yes, because the subproblems, for example, one subproblem objective function could be 8, then another could be 7, but then it could go up again and be 10. So we have to start our upper bound, because the last iteration not necessarily will account for the upper bound. Matthew, in his article, one of the references you can find in the link, explains this a little bit better. So as we mentioned, the subproblem is a dual LP problem, and the master problem is a pure IP problem. Look, that no continuous variables are involved in the master problem. So the vendor's decomposition for MIPs is of special interest when the vendor subproblem and the Relax master problem are easy to solve, while the original problem is not. So having given this introduction to the vendor's algorithm, let's analyze the model in which we will implement the vendor's algorithm, which is called the fixed charge transportation problem. Let's revise what is the original version of the transportation problem. We are considering the fixed charge feature is this. We need to minimize. Let's explain first the problem. You have a set of plants, for example, and you have a set of customers. And these plants needs to serve the customers. The plants needs to serve the customers, and you need to decide how much quantity from each plant will go to each customer. Yes, and from produce going from one plant to a customer, it has a cost. That Cij is the unit cost of transporting one unit from plant I to customer J. We use I for plant, J for customers, times the variable Xij, which is the quantity of units that I transport from plant A, from plant I to customer J. We have this couple of constraints. Yes, the first constraint that says, okay, this constraint, I take my pencil. This constraint is for each plant, for each I. Yes, and we have this other constraint, which is for each customer that we need to meet the demand. Yes, so it's the summation over I. So what I receive from all plants into customer J has to be equal to the demand of that customer. And the quantity that is into the customer has to be greater than or equal to zero for wherever the plant. The fixed charge transportation problem adds a fixed cost Fij to a link Ij. So if I send from plant I to plant J, I have to pay a fixed amount of money if I open that link. So in order to model that, we have to use extra binary variables that we are going to call Yij, yes, which indicates if a link is open or closed. Oops. How can I erase? Let me erase this. Let's keep going. So the fixed charge transportation problem adds this term to the objective function. Yes, the fixed cost of opening the link ij times the binary variable that says if the link is open or not, and this summation over all i's and j's. So you can account for all arcs in the network or links in the network. same constraint than the transportation problem, same constraint than the transportation problem, and we need an additional constraint that accounts for the relationship between the x variable and the y variable. Yeah, so if I open, or we can understand this equation like this, if x is greater than zero, yes, y has to be one to meet this constraint. But if y is equal to zero, then x has to be zero. So that's the way to model the relation, the logic between x and y. And we know that y is a binary variable, which will take values of zero and one, or one. Okay. M is a very large number, yes, but we want this number to be as small as possible. So a good value for this number, notice this, that could be the source, yes, the capacity of plant I, or the demand in J. Notice that never I'm going to send to J from I more than what I can send or more than what J can receive. So choosing this M and J as this parameter, as the minimum between these two other parameters, is a good choice to make M as small as possible. So then we can rewrite this problem in the following fashion. Objective function is the same. We can do this change to this constraint. Notice that, okay, strictly this is an equality that you have to source everything, but you can represent this with a smaller than or equal constraint. Yes, what I dispatch from a plant has to be smaller or equal to the capacity of that plant, which is this parameter S accounts for. But in order to make our things easier to formulate the tool, we're gonna multiply per times minus one in each side of these constraints, and the sign here will change of direction. So if it was smaller or equal, it becomes greater than or equal. This is the change that goes from here to here. And this constraint, notice, instead of expressing as an equality constraint, is a similar reasoning as the first one. We need that to meet at least the demand of customer J. Okay, so we can change that equal constraint into a greater than or equal constraint. This equation can be, if we pass all variables to the left hand side, can be expressed in this way. Then, look that here, if we can express our master problem from here, we can write our master problem very easily if we have this form. Yes, and we can also describe our subproblem. Yes, for our subproblem, look, all these constraints will go to the subproblem. The only constraint that stays in the master problem is this, plus the cuts that we will be generating. So for this problem, what is the objective function? So you can revise the rules to find the dual of an optimization problem, a minimization problem. So the right hand side becomes the cost coefficients in the dual, yes, and we will use the UI, the dual variable, for the first type of constraint, for the capacity constraints in the plants. So UI will be the dual variable. VJ will be the dual variable for the demand constraint. And YIJ will be the dual variable for this constraint, which is the relationship, the logic between XIJ and YIJ constraint. So this is the objective function of the dual, and applying the rules to find the dual, this is what we obtain as the constraints of the dual: minus yi plus vj minus yij smaller than or equal to say ij, Let me just write here that this has to happen for each. Oops. How can I write? Just write. This is for each I. I'm following the rules to create a tool from a primal. UI has to be greater than or equal to zero, VJ has to be greater than or equal to zero, and WIJ has to be greater than or equal to zero. Let's erase this so we can keep moving in this, keep revising this document. Let's select. Let's keep the mouse. So look, this is the sub problem. Something important, this is the dual of the sub problem. Something important here is that notice that in this dual sub problem, we don't write this expression. F transpose Y, yes. So be aware of that, because to generate the cut, we need to add this expression, and when we need to update the upper bound, we need to add this expression. What is FTY bar? So for representing the master problem. Look, Z has to be greater than or equal to the objective function. Look that this expression is no more than the objective function of the tool. You can see, plus Fy, here is Y is the summation over ij of Fij, Yij. And here we have the expression for the feasibility cut. And this has to happen for each k. Yes. And what is each k? Each k are the set of extreme points of this subproblem. All extreme points of this region described by this equation. And this is for each L, yes? And L is unbounded rate, yes? This is the expression for the feasibility cut. Let's keep going. No, okay, so that's all. What we have to do, we have to the following step. Let me check what I wanted to share with you. So we introduced the vendor's algorithm. We introduced the fixed charge transportation problem. Let's go now to
some implementation. For the implementation, let me just in this video implement the original version of the problem.
So I'm going to open Cplex. Let me close all of this. I'm going to create a new project. Find new project. Let me call it vendors implementation. This is what I will be sharing with you. Let's create our original model first, and solve the original model. So let me here. This is the each charge transportation problem. And let's start our implementation in Cplex. So let's start the implementation of the fixed charge transportation problem. Let me create here my scheme of what I'm going to do. First, I'm going to define the sets, and I will define the parameters of the model. You come in with this symbol here in Cplex, then we do the variable definition, then the object, the model. In the model, we first would define the objective function, the constraints, and the constraints.
Right. So
for our set, in the sets, let's define the elements as strings, and let's call the set of plans. For this program, we will have the following plans. It's here, I'm doing the same that this guy does. So he has plans from I1 to I4. So he has four plans and three customers. Let's do that. I1, I2, I3, I4.
Customers.
Keep working, save definitions. Error. Let me check. I forgot the codes here. Element of each set in quotes. One, two, three, four. Any better to write from here? All right, we have defined our sets. Then let's define now our parameters. Okay. So which parameters do we have? We have a cost. Yes. So we have the cost, and the cost of sending one unit from one plan to one customer is, this parameter is indexed in the set of plans and the set of customers. Let me, writing all values of the cost, I'm just going to copy paste from here that I have this ready. These are the elements of this parameter. What are the parameters we have? We have the parameter of supply. Yes, and the capacity of the plant. So the supply is indexed just in the set of plants. Let me copy paste this parameter that is, I've got it already here. And remember the semicolon to index the
explanation of each parameter. Which other parameter do we need? We need
the parameter of the demand. Yes, and the demand is a parameter indexed in the set of customers. And what is the demand of the customers? Let me bring it from here that we have it ready. We need the parameter of the cost, you know, or not.
this parameter is from L and source index set. Nice. Customer. What is the parameter that we need from the model? The parameter M. Float. Let me customers. I already did the calculation of the minimum between the demand and the capacity. So let me just write to you the result of that, doing that operation. And this is M.
In our original problem,
what we have two variables. Yes, to define a variable, we say dbar. We have a continuous variable, so we're going to define float plus x, which is indexed in plans customers. If you do control space, look, you just automatically write this quick tree that is also using other type of programming languages. We have this variable. Other variable, but this other variable is not continuous, it's integer, yes, which is the variable y. And it's also indexed in plans and customers, that's why I just copy paste that. And I'm going to define that this variable is a binary variable. So a way to define that this variable is a binary variable, I say in 0.2.1. Okay. Let's go now for our objective function.
Our objective function, this is a recommended practice in C++.
Separately the objective function expressions. Let me write this expression. It should be a continuous expression. Let me call this the total variable cost to be equal to the cost of sending the product from plant to customers. This will be the sum of I in plants, J in customers. Yes, in C++ we write the index of summation in this then the brackets and then write the expression. And what is the expression?
Yeah,
the cost of sending one unit, which is Cij, times the quantity of units that I send. This is the total variable cost. Let's do the same, but to calculate the total fixed cost. Total fixed cost, summation over I and j of what? Cij, no, of Fij, which is the fixed cost, times the variable y that denotes if I open up a link. The objective function, so we can write our objective function as minimize the total variable cost plus the total fixed cost.
For our constraints, we will write that this objective function is subject to open curly brackets, is subject to what? To the let me label that constraint. Okay. That this, so before labeling the constraint, let's say that
for all plants in I in the set
of plants, we're going to define the supply
la función in simplex, supply capacity. We are going to zoom over J in the customers. I'm going to zoom, I'm going to zoom X and J. And this
has to be a smaller equal than our supply. Let me write down the customer demand
constraint. I copy paste the previous constraint to make it quicker. So it's not for all I implants, it will be for all JE customers. Okay, I just copy paste. Let's call this constraint the demand satisfaction constraint. And this will be the summation over all I implants of Xij has to be how smaller, no, sorry, greater than or equal than the demand of the customer. And the customer, we are using the index to represent the customer. So this is the original optimization model of the fictional transportation problem, and I want to finish this video solving this problem. So to solve this problem in Cplex, what we need to do is that we need to create a run configuration. Let's create a run configuration.
Let's call it original problem.
Run configuration original problem. And to this
run configuration, let's associate this .mod file load. It's just dragging this element. I think everything here should be okay. This is a mistake. This is the mistake I had. What else do I have? All good. Maybe these dots are not there. Yes, these dots shouldn't be there. Okay, more mistakes. Let's check what is the problem now. Oh, sorry, here, more problems. I need to define, you need to define a set that has string elements. I was lacking these curly brackets here. So now everything seems okay. Let's run this. Okay, I just right click here, set run, and we will be able to read our objective function here is 220. Let me check if that's right with the example I had already built. Let me compare with this. Let me compare with what I had already done. 350. Yes, the objective function is not 220, it's 250. Something is not working well. Let's find out what's going on. Very important. We need an additional constraint. We were forgetting one constraint, the relation constraint. So let's write our relation constraint for all I implants. Let me call this constraint this constraint says that x ij has to be smaller equal than m ij times y I.
Solve this again, it should give the solution should be 350. Let's go for it. Where did I create this Bender's implementation? The recorded version. Let's run this. This is a good indicator that everything is working now.
So let me finish this video here. In the following video, I will show you how to implement the automatic features of Cplex to implement vendors. So thanks for watching. Yes, hope it is useful for you. See you in the next video.